Pittsburgh Buddhist Center and Cleveland Buddhist Vihara. Born and trained in Sri Lanka, he moved to the US in 2008 and earned a PhD in religious studies from the University of Pittsburgh in 2017. He teaches Buddhism, mindfulness, meditation, and provides spiritual counseling to help people to deal with the challenging issues of life. So please join me in extending a warm welcome to Bhante Pema.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to, appreciate and thank for this invitation. It is an honor to be with you all, and we deeply appreciate your effort. Your Interfaith Power and Light organization, your effort to generate more awareness of, this loving Mother Earth and everything that we live in. Thank you very much. So I will be giving this presentation together with George. We are both part of a Buddhist society of Pittsburgh. We have a number of Buddhist organizations as members of that, Buddhist society of Pittsburgh. I'm from Pittsburgh Buddhist Center in Ellison Park. So the George will be, presenting later. So my presentation will be more on theoretical side, what are the Buddhist insights or Buddhist teachings on the environment, and what kind of teachings that are relevant that can guide us or inform us our decisions and our interactions with our nature and the environment. So I'm going to share my screen and based on the PowerPoint presentation first. Let me So I hope that you can see my slides now. So the caring for all life, that is the theme of the talk. Of course, the different, religions and philosophies will provide deeper understanding about ourselves and the world that we live in. I think each spiritual tradition presents important teachings for us to understand that, we are living in a much larger universe. We ourselves are not the, center of the universe. So I think the Buddhist teachings also have, have that similar message. But let me go into the detail of that. So there's an important principle in the Buddhist tradition that explains the operation of the natural world, or you can even call underlying principles of natural world. And for all life and all, natural nature and everything, universe is operating based on this particular principle, and it is called dependent co-arising or paticca-samuppada. It's more like a cause and effect kind of theory, it is not called cause and effect because in the dependent co-arising this doctrine, this theory, it is given that there's not one cause that may produce one result, and it's always there can be multiple causes that may lead into multiple, results. So it's more complex than simply cause and effect relationship. So the whole natural world is operating, all our life is operating under this principle called dependent co-arising. That means interdependence. Everything that we experience in our life, everything in the natural world, and is interdependent. So the existence of one thing is dependent on others. So this doctrine of dependent co-arising, sometimes called dependent origination, and it explains that nothing exists by itself in the world. If anything to exist, it has to rely on something else. So everything is relying on each other, and then we can exist. So the whole Buddhist idea of emptiness come from this doctrine. That is to what we mean by emptiness is actually empty of independent existence. So things exist, we live, and many other natural phenomena exist, but nothing exists by itself. And so everything is empty of independent existence. And that is the whole idea of emptiness. So we can identify, things exist, things form, things arise, things, but everything is relying on each other. So what is the kind of the vision of life that is presented with this doctrine is that we are all interconnected of the same web of life. So this interconnectedness or interdependence, not simply connected, but actually depending. So every piece of life is depending on the many other, pieces of life. Therefore, because we are interdependent on each other, that is also interresponsible. We are also interresponsible to each other because our whole existence is depend on many other, lives and things around us. So therefore, this doctrine, what we call dependent origination, is kind of guiding us to appreciate the, web of life and then identify the intricacies of this interdependence and interconnection and then respect all life because everything is depending on each other. So usually when we deal with the natural world, when we deal with our environment and we have this image in the mind that somehow human beings are, on one side, and we are the consumers of the natural world, or we are the, one who use the natural world. So we have this idea that, we on the one side, and the our natural world on the other side, and we are the consumers of the natural world. But this is not a correct picture of the actual reality. And so with this doctrine of dependent origination, we should train our mind to get rid of this wrong view, a wrong vision that we are the maybe the owners of the natural world, or maybe we are the consumers of the natural world, or we are somehow in opposition to natural world. We are on this side and the natural world on the other side. We are here to consume it. So that kind of vision has to be corrected. So this whole doctrine of dependent origination helping us to change that kind of wrong view. So instead of that, we have to see here our existence in our world is something like this. You can see human beings are an important part of this whole interconnected web. But, the animals, plants, earth, water, and all other beings are kind of, helping each other, relying on each other. So that helps whole thing to move. So we are simply a important part of a whole system. And so, of course, we had to consume for us to survive. But we also have to contribute to the whole system, and we are not special in that sense. So we understanding that we are simply part of the whole system and not separate from it, or not someone has a special privileges. But of course, as human beings, we may have more responsibility because of our abilities. For example, animals also have responsibility towards the natural environment. But as human beings, because we can act more than animals, and so we may have more responsibility than the other, parts of the system. So we may be special in that sense because we have a larger responsibility because of our capacity to damage the environment, or because of our capacity our capacity to act. We have a lot of potential to act or disturb or intervene the whole system, And because our capacity is higher, and therefore our responsibility to take care of it also higher. So usually this interdependency is not apparent to our ordinary mind. So usually our ordinary mind sees things as separate. It's also construct a notion of a separate self. And our normally our habitual mind is constructing that separation and also that notion of a separate individual self that is different from the rest of the world. And that happens habitually. So therefore, and that illusion of independent self in opposition to interdependent self, usually we have illusion of independent self that give rise to emotions like greed and hatred. Therefore, so as a result, our human behavior is driven by this greed and hatred, which is based on that illusion of independent self. And that creates a lot of problems for the whole world. And not only that, actually problems for the very individual himself or herself too. So the whole Buddhist practice is aiming to help us to change this illusion, change this wrong view. So the Buddhist path, the practice that, you know, Buddhists are supposed to follow, aiming at overcoming this delusion and also negative emotions. So one technique is you know, through mindfulness and constant reflection of our, you know, dependency on other things. One can so through constant mindfulness and constant reflection, and through, you know, good, you know, education, learning, we can develop an understanding into this interdependency of our life or anything else. It's not simply apparent to our ordinary mind. We had to make an effort to have a penetration to this deeper reality that is beyond our surface level of understanding. So in deep meditation, like when we can deepen our concentration and our settled state of the mind, and we can directly experience this interdependence of everything. And so there's two levels of understanding of this interdependency. One is conceptual understanding, conceptually correcting our view and our vision, and then going to a deeper level of meditation, and then directly experience and directly experience that, you know, every moment in our life is supported by so many other things around us. And there's no moment, no even simple, you know, single moment in our life that we live by ourselves. And so, but that direct experience comes through to deeper calm, calmer mind and deeper settled mind. Okay. So what we usually tend to take self is actually in reality inseparable from other things and the nature. So we have an individual self, but it is constructed through all the things that is what is not self. So once we understand this truth, we develop, you know, deep gratitude towards many things that contributed. Our very self that we have constructed and we are constructing, you know, continuously, and it's also develop compassion for everything that will continue to help us to survive. So as a result, we develop deep respect for all forms of life. So in order for us to, you know, get this idea, you know, I would like you to take a moment to like do reflection. I hope that we all had our breakfast, right? I think we all have our breakfast. So think about, you know, what did you have for your breakfast this morning? Maybe yogurt, you know, maybe, you know, some milk, maybe some fruit or smoothie, or maybe bread. You know, take a moment to think about actually what did you, you know, eat for your breakfast. And think about that, you know, before you eat your breakfast, that food is not part of us. Maybe it is in our home, but it is not really part of us. And that food that was in your kitchen is actually produced by, you know, so many produced as a result of the labor of so many people, and also as a result of contribution from the natural world. So it is a gift that is available for us as a result of the contribution of so many beings and so many plants and, you know, natural world. And then you ate that food. And now what is happening with that food now? I'm sure that many of us are digesting that food, right? So soon, whatever you have taken as breakfast will digest. And then part of it will become a part of your body. So what was outside, now is inside. And what was not us now becoming part of us. And so that breakfast will become your muscles, you know, your blood and so many things in you. So and then all the you know, things that we consider as our body is actually is the things that we have eaten so far. So no one is born like this, you know. So we were small creatures, and then we developed this body as a result of, you know, what we have eaten so far. And so all the food that was not self, that was outside and came into us and became part of us. And then we are also, you know, that's not the end of the cycle. We also now again also contribute to the rest of the, you know, cycle. So you can understand that how our, you know, division, separation from the self and the rest is very arbitrary. And our self is constantly constructed. And is, you know, only if you only think about the physical aspect of it, and if we are always, you know, taking what is not self and constructing the self, and then we are also contributing again to the whole, you know, rest of the world. So mental is also the same, but, you know, if we can understand that that the reality of our physical, you know, body that we consider ourselves, we can understand how it is produced by so many other things in the world. So when you deeply, you know, realize that, you know, our dependency and our reliance on the whole, you know, natural world and our very existence of self, existence of individual is depending on so many other people and other things, we develop deep gratitude. A deep gratitude that, you know, my whole life has been made possible by so many things around me, and then of course deep compassion. And as a result, we develop deep respect for all forms of life. So that compassion and gratitude has a big impact on the natural world. In the Buddhist understanding, our morality, you know, moral qualities of human beings is directly affecting the environment. Usually it's there are so many narratives, so many teachings in the Buddhist sources, which shows that how the moral degeneration of people affect the nature. For example, there's a sutra called Agganya Sutra. In that sutra, you find description of early phase of human civilization on this globe, and it shows that at the originally, you know, there were the earth was full of resources, and people had to make only less effort to find their basic needs. There it says that there was self-growing rice on the earth, and you don't have to, you know, remove the, you know, the husk of it, and it was ready to eat. So it was so easy for people to go and eat because they were self-growing rice with nice fragrance. But what happened is that the human beings started to, you know, hoard those food, and then develop more craving about that. So due to hoarding of the food and then greed that arose on that food, and then of course, like stealing and lying, And those kind of immoral behaviors started to appear among human beings as a result that self-growing rice disappeared from the earth. So the richness of the earth got diminished as a result of degeneration of moral qualities of human beings. So the message is that more morally poor we are, that the immoral qualities influence the natural world, and then it has a direct impact. And there's another sutra where Buddha describe, how human beings, when human beings are full of immoral behavior, their lifespan also gets shorter and shorter. And this sutra also predicts that it is possible that, we may reduce our lifespan into 10 years, as low as 10 years, if the immoral behavior continues. Because it affects the body and the natural world. And then the immorality becomes widespread in the society, and the timely rain does not fall. And when the timely rain does not fall, the crops get adversely affected. As a result, hunger and malnourishment can become common. So these two sutras showing that how the moral qualities and the mental states of human beings are affecting the natural world, the resource of the natural world can offer. And there's a direct connection between the moral qualities and natural world, natural resources in the world. So there is also teachings like when human beings are full of greed, famine can become the natural outcome. When human beings have a lot of hatred, obviously violence will become the natural outcome. When human beings are full of confusion and lack of understanding and interdependence, epidemic can be the result. So this famine, violence, and epidemic has direct relationship with the mental state of the human beings, greed, hatred, and ignorance. So that connection is given there. So as a result, I think what we had to do is to engage, live in this world with that deep gratitude and compassion, and also to understand that our consumption, our level of consumption is the key, or maybe the roots of our environmental crisis. The level of consumption and underlying greed is the root cause of our disasters or crisis that we are experiencing. So therefore, we need to think about responsible consumption. So how we can live without being a burden to this whole system? We have to use natural resources. We have to rely on the natural resources to live. But how we can do it without being a burden? So simplicity and contentment are praised and are encouraged in the Buddhist practice as a way to as a healthy practice, not only to the whole ecosystem but also the individual. So being simple, maybe being contented in our consumption, is definitely healthy for the whole system, but it's also healthy for the individual. So there's an emphasis in the Buddhist teaching to show that true happiness, true joy, true satisfaction in person comes not in the when we consume a lot. So the incessant consumption does not give us satisfaction or happiness or fulfillment. So it's a failed project. We try to consume a lot. We try to consume as much as we can, thinking that our quality of life will be higher. Our level of satisfaction will be higher. But on the contrary, the reality is that our higher level of consumption does not guarantee us true happiness. So there's an advice from the Buddha that one should earn one's wealth like a bee collects honey from a flower. So that's an example given, like how a bee will collect honey from the flower. That is how we should earn our wealth. We should make our living, and we should consume what we need. So we know that bees or the butterflies, they rely on the flowers, but they know to take the nectar without harming. even the petals, you know, of the flowers. But at the same time, they're also contributing back to the whole system by, you know, pollinating these, you know, plants. So that's the kind of example given by the Buddha for us to live our life, you know, how we can make our living and how we should live our life, you know, be like a bee. You know, that is the guidance. So I can, those are from the original, the earlier texts, Buddhist texts, but I would like to give you two modern monks, the statement of the modern monks who are environmentally, who are activists in a way to protect the environment and natural world. So Buddhadasa Bhikkhu is from Thailand, and he said that when we can realize that the world is mutual, interdependent, cooperative enterprise, then we can build a noble environment. Noble environment. If our lives are not based on this truth, then we will perish. And then of course, the other most well-known environmentalist and the great Buddhist teacher, Thich Nhat Hanh, has said, we need to realize that the earth is not just our environment. Earth is not something outside of us. Breathing with mindfulness and contemplating your body, you realize that you are the earth. So these are the, you know, the reflection, maybe modern presentation of the, you know, the Buddhist teachings that you know we can find here. So this is more like a theoretical, you know, presentation I can give you. And this, I hope that, you know, you got some understanding how the Buddhist teachings will see the existence of the whole universe, natural world, and how it sees the human being as important but a small part, you know, of that whole system. And then we have the responsibility of we need to develop this deep gratitude and compassion for the rest of the world, and at the same time have a more responsible sense of consumption. So the key is, you know, what we consume and how much we consume, and then also deep understanding and deep emotional connection that we should, you know, develop with the natural world. So that's what I have prepared to offer you today. So maybe we can have more discussion during our Q&A. Okay, now I would like to, you know, give chance to George or the moderator.
Thank you, Bhante Pema. That was wonderful and so rich, so much learning even for myself. So thank you for sharing so generously with us. I am so delighted to also welcome to the space George. George is a native of Philadelphia who worked for 30 years in the factory automation industry. He later supported developments in renewable energy policy and systems with Citizens for Pennsylvania's Future through Penn Future and Native Energy of Vermont. In 2007, George was trained by former Vice President Al Gore to present the slideshow from the film An Inconvenient Truth, and has given dozens of presentations to audiences, including senior management at large companies. In the early 1990s, George discovered engaged Buddhist teachings of Zen Master Thich Nhat Hanh. Since then, he has been active in mindfulness Sangha communities in Philadelphia, Vermont, and Pittsburgh. George was ordained by Thich Nhat Hanh into the monastic and lay order of Interbeing in 2013. In 2015, he helped found the Earthholder community, an earth justice initiative in Thich Nhat Hanh's tradition, which has since expanded to more than 61 countries. So we're delighted to welcome George here to share his wisdom with us also.
Thank you much, Katie, and thank you all for being here, and thank you, Bhante, for so beautifully setting up our understanding of what it means in Buddhism related to the environment. I am going to share some slides, and just a few slides, but a couple of short videos, and I have the ability. So I would like to kind of speak to the issue of action. Bhante, I agree that that's what I would focus on. And I want to use the format and structure that you may be familiar with Let me get this thing out of the way. Okay. From Gianna Macy's nomenclature, she talks about elements of change and particularly related to climate change. So, you know, the aspects of stopping the harm and mitigation, demanding that of new forms like clean energy, as we know, and also a very important element, changing consciousness and changing culture, which is really partly what Bhante was just talking about. And that's really where we tend to see Buddhists more than in the contemplative side. But we're also there in stopping the harm. You know, the Buddhists are out in the street when we need to be asking for what we want. Here's a good example. But seriously, in the last 10, 15 years, in particular, we've seen the Buddhist community very strongly together with Buddhist Peace Fellowship, the Buddhist Action Coalition out of New York, One Earth Sangha, the Earth Holder Sangha that I just was just mentioned by Katie that I helped get started. Here in the front there, We Are the Earth, tied into what Bhante was just sharing, are some of our monastics and some of our lay people. This is in New York, I think, in 2017. And what I'd like to share quickly is some other actions of the Earth Holder Sangha. In a short video that we made for Thich Nhat Hanh for his 90th birthday, to let him know that we were continuing his work. He actually started work on the environment in 1970. So I'd like to offer that now. And I'm asking the question, I guess, can you hear this? I'm going to step out of the slides for just a second. Were you able to hear the sound with that? Oh, okay. I didn't necessarily click share sound there, so I'm apologize. I didn't share the sound. All right, so I wanted to make sure you could hear it. And I'll step on beyond that. Oops, no. Yes, okay. So I wanted to say, as Katie was mentioning, we started, about 40 of us started that in 2014, 2015. And at our 2023rd retreat, we had 1,500 people worldwide participating in that from 61 countries, 700 of whom were at our monastery in France, and 800 of us online. And really underpinning that particular retreat was the book published after Thich Nhat Hanh's passing. He passed in 2021. But the book is really a compilation of his teachings and some editing from the monastics. It's called Zen and the Art of Saving the Planet. And there's actually a 7-week course. I think March 24th will start the third time this course is being offered, and it is open to all traditions and faiths. And I'd like to just give you the final underpinning of that with a small small video, which is from the abbot of our Deer Park Monastery, which is out near San Diego, and he's speaking about really the underpinning that we've kind of evolved to in the middle of this course.
In the title of the book, Zen of the Art of Saving the Planet, I really enjoy the title. It has a lot of reference to one of my favorite book of the motorcycle maintenance. I think maybe some of you have heard. But the word Zen is a very, it's a Japanese word, but it means meditation. Jhana, it's a translation from the Sanskrit word jhana, which is meditation or cultivation. So the meditation is not the exact translation, but the word cultivation is even more appropriate. Now here we're cultivating the mind, cultivating our lives, and cultivating a certain kind of energy. So the word Zen can be kind of like a cultivated person, someone who has been trained, whose mind is trained in a certain way. So. And the energy we use is mindfulness, right? This energy is a very internal spiritual energy. When I learned about meditation, especially in the Vietnamese tradition, the word they use for Zen is thiền. And if you're trained enough in the meditation or the monastery, then they look at a person who's a meditator, a monastic, or a practitioner, they say you have the thiền vị, so that the flavor, the taste of Zen. So someone has a Zen flavor. So in our work, whether we're in our lives, in our service, in our activist work, in our engagement for social change, I think, we look at the current situation, we need more of that Zen flavor. And that's why I like the word Zen in the title. It means how can we bring more of a Zen flavor to the work of bettering our environment, bettering our humanity, our relationship with Mother Earth. Brother Phuplin, Brother Spirit, and I had a chance to attend the COP 26 in Glasgow. And what we brought there was our practice and the way we walk, the way we participated, and to bring that kind of Zen energy there. So it's a way of being at the conference. And it was quite a contrast. There's a lot of people rushing around in the work of, trying to organize and recalculate our relationship in terms of carbon footprint and many, many other endeavors to help lower our effect, our impact on our planet. There was a lot of stress, a lot of anger, a lot of confrontation we felt, a lot of tension in people, in their bodies, in their mind. And so my brother and I, we led meditation every morning. And that is to bring that sense of, yes, we need work, and there's important work that needs to be done. But how do we do it? Does it have a flavor of Zen? And here, the flavor of Zen here is a kind of lightness. Yes, it's important. Yes, it's dire. Yes, it is urgent situation that our planet and that we find ourselves in. Yes, it is important for us to do the work that we need to do. But how do we do it? The way in which we do it. Do we sacrifice our relationship, sacrifice the present moment to achieve our goal? So in Zen, to have the Zen flavor is to be at ease, to be free from that. So the way we approach, we don't sacrifice that. Sacrifice the present moment, sacrifice our relationship to achieve our goal. And that is exactly the same kind of mentality that has brought us into trouble. This very striving and, very tense approach. So that's what it means to have the Zen flavor. It's a kind of energy, it's a kind of core spiritual energy.
Thank you for this opportunity. And I think, Katie, I think then we go to questions.
Yeah, thank you both. I will be facilitating Q&A today. Thank you both for your wonderful presentations. And thank you for sharing your time with us this afternoon. I have learned so much. So thank you for being in this space with us today. And for those who don't know me, my name is Raina Kawimer, and I am the Advocacy and Outreach Manager at PAIPL. And I'm being mindful of the fact that we're ending at 1 p.m. We've got about 15 minutes for Q&A, and so I'm going to start by just highlighting the questions that are already in the chat. But please feel free to ask more questions in the chat as they come to you, or raise your hand. The first that I see is from Daniel Wolk. And the question is, does Buddhist teaching offer any parallels between living with and addressing our environmental crises and living with chronic illness such as cancer?
Bhante, do you want to?
You can start, George. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Living with chronic illness and the degradation of the planet, if I understood. Within our traditions, in our particular tradition, we have something called the five remembrances, and that we remember. So it's a meditation that we do. So the first meditation is breathing in, I am aware that I am of the nature to grow old. And breathing out, I know that there's no escape. We sit with that. Breathing in, I know I'm of the nature to become of ill health. Breathing out, I know there's no escape. We sit with that. Breathing in, I know I'm of the nature to die. And breathing out, we know that there's no escape that. So we sit with that. Breathing in, I know that all that I treasure and all my family and all that I treasure cannot go with me, right? There's no escape. Breathing out, there's no escape. And we sit with that. And finally, we breathe with only our words and our actions stay with us and travel with us, but also stay with our family and travel. So we're breathing with that. And we've added a sixth one, and that is breathing and aware that this planet, this civilization is of the nature to die. Breathing out, we realize there's no escape to that. there's impermanence. So impermanence, like no self, which Bhante was talking about, impermanence is one of the three major core principles of Buddhism. And so in that, we kind of come, it's almost like coming to that acceptance of Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, if you know those, you know, denial, anger, negotiation, resignation, acceptance. And then after acceptance, we can act freely. So Buddhism is really about freedom and in the awareness of impermanence and acceptance. So I don't know if that answers it properly, but.
Yeah, I think with chronic illness, we had to develop deep, you know, acceptance and then see life beyond our limited human body. But with environmental crisis, we should not stop at the level of acceptance, you know, because we can do something about it. Mm-hmm. And so we have to move beyond, well, of course, accepting and then being, and then moving forward to develop more, you know, healthy environment and natural world.
Thank you both for those really insightful answers. I'm going to move on then. We have a question from Vince Riley that asks, is it correct to characterize Thich Nhat Hanh's Tian Buddhism as a type of sudden enlightenment Buddhism, similar to Chinese Chan Buddhism or Japanese Zen Buddhism? Zen Buddhism.
I guess I'll take that. Thich Nhat Hanh came out of the Zen, Rinzai Zen tradition. But he also incorporated, so he's in, there's several major schools in Buddhism, as there are several major schools in Christianity. And the Mahayana school is where the Zen is founded in that particular school. So our tradition comes out of that, but it's also combined with understanding from the insight meditation, which has more reflection. So as an example, when we are meditating, sometimes we'll use a guide, like I just showed, to try to look deeply and stop. So I would say we're connected to, yes, the Chinese, and Zen came out of Vietnam into China. And then back into Southern Asia. So I don't know, Bhante, if you might, you're much more of a student of the traditions than I am. So.
Yeah, I think, you know, the Thich Nhat Hanh had the more wider approach to the Zen tradition. I think sudden enlightenment is mainly with the Soto Zen tradition. I think he's following that element too, but I think Thich Nhat Hanh had more like a more broad approach. He will utilize, you know, elements from other schools also to promote his teachings. Yeah. He's not limited to Zen, although he's based in Zen.
All right, thank you both. I'm just going to, I've got an observation to share with everyone from Dana. Bhante mentioned how the food of the earth is integrated into our bodies, and that reminded me of how trees, especially when bare, look like the nerves in our brain. That's an awesome observation. Wondering if either of you have comments about that.
That's a nice observation.
Awesome. Thank you, Dana. Well, we have a couple more minutes for questions. I'm going to just sit and feel free to raise your hand if a question comes to you or put in the chat. I'll just allow a little bit of time for that. And then if we don't have any more questions, I will invite Katie back into the space for some closing remarks.
I have a question, if no one else will go. I'm wondering if both of you want to take a moment to maybe offer us a reflection or an observation on what you think is something that Buddhism might uniquely offer to us You've shared many things today about the intersections between Buddhist belief and care for the environment. I'm wondering if there's anything that you particularly find uniquely insightful or wisdom holding for you in your own practice around the environment, or something that you believe your tradition offers to our wider interfaith spaces as we care for the environment together.
I think among the many, you know, insights we can learn from Buddhist tradition, one thing I would highlight is that actually to understand that our true happiness comes not through consumption a lot, but our true happiness comes through simple life and contentment. So that will be a really important guidance for us to, you know, to make our decisions, you know, live our life. I think if people truly understand that, you know, our genuine satisfaction, happiness, will not come through, you know, consuming a lot, that can have a big impact on how we, you know, live our life and how we treat the natural resources.
I think the only thing I would like to add, thank you, Bhante, is you know, this idea of having a real spiritual practice. In our tradition, we have a saying, and we actually have a what's it called? It's a series of, not blogs, a podcast, I guess it's called, or whatever. It's like 50 or 60 of them now, and they're all titled The Way Out Is In. And the way out of this problem is in. It's really getting connected to ourselves and to the earth, from which we can have energy. So one of the things that we're focusing on is, do we water seeds of despair or do we water seeds of joy and happiness? And if we, even in the face of this, and I think that's what our abbot, Brother Fab Hume was saying, is that in the face of this tragedy, we know it's dire and we act, but we need to bring joy to it. We need to enjoy what's there too. And that happiness fuels us in our work. And it gives us the ability to communicate with the people on the other side who we think are the ones doing it, you know, like them, right? So it takes away the them, and we recognize that we're there and we can open up a conversation. And that's really what's important, I think, in saving the planet, is a conversation where we respect each other and work together. So,
thank you. I do see a couple more questions in the chat. Did we answer? I see one from Tom. Is there a positive arc toward the return of the original world, or is everything up for grabs?
I'll say quickly, it depends on what you consider the original world. How far back do you want to go? If you want to go back a short period of time to when the human beings came on the planet, probably not. If you want to go back to way before human beings were on the planet, we may be heading in that direction. So I don't know that it's going to be the world of 1950 or 1948 when I was born, but you know, there is still some rejuvenation, there is some regeneration, but I, you know, obviously a lot of it's been gone. So I don't want to, if you have any comments on that.
There'll be no natural, it depends on our effort, right? So I think rather than going back to the natural world, I think we can think about forward, you know, how we can create, how we can get together and help support each other and then create a healthy world.
Well, I know that Rainika has to jump, and we're like right ending at the end of our hour, which always passes so much more quickly than I anticipate it will. I'm deeply grateful to both Bhante Pema and George for joining us today. I know we have some additional questions in the chat, and George, I don't know if you very quickly just want to answer if you're aware of any local Buddhist organizations that are working on around current efforts. So the person in the chat is asking specific about the regional greenhouse gas program, but wondering if you or Bhante Pema are aware of any Buddhist specific efforts that are happening at the state level.
At the state level, is that what you said?
Yes.
I cannot say I'm not aware of something specifically at the state level.
Yeah, I am also not. We might be the closest, the closest thing to it provide in the way that we provide an interfaith convening space for those kind of conversations. So you're in the right place. I wanted to just remind folks that this is the final offering in our series, at least for now. Hopefully this is a bye for now and not forever. And I'm very grateful to our series co-sponsors, which include Better Path Coalition, Delaware Interfaith Power and Light. Shout out to Aaron and the team that's doing wonderful work there, along with Green Muslims. And then also want to thank both the Pittsburgh Buddhist Center and the Earthholder community for also helping to co-sponsor today's program. If you need to jump, I invite you to do so, but I would actually like to send us out with a passage that I invited us in on when we first gathered back in October. This is a passage from Bell Hooks's book, All About Love. And I find it to be just as relevant now as I did 6 months ago, and so would like to close the space out today with this reading. So,
Katie, could I say one thing before we get off?
yes, you may.
There is a website called pittsburghbuddhist.org, and that website shows all of the Buddhist community in Pittsburgh, the different local centers and so forth. And that will also have a link to an upcoming event, May 5th, where the Buddhist community is coming together to celebrate the Buddha's birthday. And it's kind of like the Christmas in Buddhism. And so you could go to pittsburghbuddhist.org to find that.
That's wonderful. And if you send me that link, George, I'll make sure it's included in the follow-up email, and we'll also put it up on our website so that folks can know and be involved too. That sounds wonderful. All right, so this is a passage from Bell Hooks. Spiritual life is first and foremost about commitment to a way of thinking and behaving that honors principles of interbeing and interconnectedness. When I speak of the spiritual, I refer to the recognition within everyone that there is a place of mystery in our lives where forces that are beyond human desire or will alter circumstances and/or guide and direct us. I call these forces divine spirit. When we choose to live a spirit life, we recognize and celebrate the presence of transcendent spirits. Some people call this presence soul, God, the beloved, higher consciousness, or higher power. Still others say that this force is what it is because it cannot be named. To them, it is simply the spirit moving in us and through us. A commitment to spiritual life necessarily means we embrace the principle that love is all, everything, and our true destiny. Despite overwhelming pressure to conform to a culture of lovelessness, we still seek to know love. That seeking is itself a manifestation of divine spirit. Life-threatening nihilism abounds in contemporary culture, crossing the boundaries of race, class, gender, and nationality. At some point, it affects all of our lives. Everyone I know is at times brought low by feelings of depression and despair about the state of the world. Whether it is ongoing worldwide presence of violence expressed by the persistence of man-made war, hunger, and starvation, the day-to-day reality of violence, the presence of life-threatening diseases that cause the unexpected deaths of friends, comrades, and loved ones. There is much that brings everyone to the brink of despair. Knowing love, or the hope of knowing love, is the anchor that keeps us from falling into that sea of despair. In A Path with a Heart, Jack Kornfield shares, the longing for love and the movement for love is underneath all of our activities. So I want to leave you on that note. Thank you for taking this journey with us as we all journey deeper into love and knowing whether that is how to love each other better, our sacred home better, and all the other ways that we seek to lean into love together. So thank you for being here on this journey with us.
It's so nice to have you all. And so thank you very much again for this invitation. And we will look forward to continue our mission, you know, one mission to build a healthier Mother Earth.